who've never heard of Big Heritage, it's not really that easy to explain what sort of a company we are. We're a private company, but we're not a commercial unit. We're a group of archaeologists, historians, educators that are quite passionate about using what an area's got to help itself and for education. For example, last year in Chester, we were hired to put, because there's a large proportion of people who are very intimidated about walking into art galleries and museums. My boss came up with this crazy idea of let's make the whole city centre a museum. And we had what was called Hoot Root, Hoot being like the little... Can you not hear me? Sorry. Is that better? No? Not Tom? Is that better? So at Big Heritage are archaeologists, educators and historians. Can you hear that one? No? Makes no difference? The light's on? No? I'll try and shout. Is that better? There you go. If I get shouting, very violent, tell me off. So, I've been with a school group these last couple of days, so maybe my voice is having a little rest and I'm being quiet. You're okay. I'll
spare microphone.
No. Oh, there we go. Magic. Thank you. Is that better? Can you hear me a little bit better now? Excellent. Wonderful. Yeah, I've been working with the school for the last couple of days. We've been digging with a primary school. And so I've been talking all the time to children, which is a delight, but your throat gets a little bit sore sometimes. So Big Heritage, I'll repeat for those that didn't hear, we're a group of archaeologists, historians and educators that believe very strongly in using what an area's got to promote itself and for education purposes. So one of the things we did, as a lot of people are very intimidated about going into art galleries and museums, my boss had this mad idea of let's turn the whole of Chester into a museum. And with the cooperation and great help from the Groves Museum in Chester, we went into their archives and we got 30 different artifacts that we placed in shops all around Chester that you accidentally found or could then follow a trail. And it was the response we got from it was absolutely amazing. People loved it. And it just made heritage, if you like this elusive term, heritage, available to people who wouldn't normally go into a museum or an art gallery to access it. And that's the sort of thing we really like to do, to make things available to people that they would otherwise be slightly intimidated by doing. Excellent, it's working for me. We do most of our work in Merseyside and on the Wirral. But ironically, the one thing I'm going to talk to you about today is Dig Blaken, because it really does show how funding from outside the normal and how it can really work well, but you just have to be a little bit imaginative and possibly a little bit brave in doing things, you know, taking that leap. Blaken is an area just outside Chester with large areas of quite severe deprivation. It hits sort of the bottom 10% in the whole country for early mortality, health issues, the fewer people going to university, all the things that are sort of levels of affluence or even a steady economy, just doesn't happen there. Huge areas of deprivation. And so Cheshire, Western Chester Health Authority came to us as a company and said, we want you to do an archaeological dig in Blaken and we want you to base it around health. And so we thought, yeah, how as serious archaeologists, how do you actually make that work? How can you make being given some funding to dig in an area without the prior research and make it archaeologically sound and robust? Or, you know, we as archaeologists, you can't just put spades into soil just because you fancy it. It's just not right in any way.
Really?
So what they wanted the focus to be on health and activity, not on archaeology. But they wanted us to use the archaeological process to do that. So it did make quite a few big meetings at work. How do we go about doing this? What's the way we can do it? And how do we make it robust, for want of a better word. Don't need to tell any of you here what's the first thing you have to do. You have to do your DBA. Sit down and you make it more robust than ever, because it's not something that you've been researching and gone through the normal channels and we want to dig here. Get your maps out. Maps are always a marvellous thing. Access the HER. If you're not really, really thorough in the preparation, then you shouldn't excavate. I'm a great believer that you don't excavate unless there's a really good reason for excavation. We've just had this huge thing. I'm sure everyone around here heard the huge hoo-ha over the amphitheatre in Chester. You know, it was quite horrible. Some of the stuff that was going on, it was quite horrible, but people really wanted to excavate the amphitheatre. They weren't concerned about where all this money was going to come from. They wanted the rest of it. They wanted to knock down a listed building, dig up the rest of the amphitheatre. And as much as I can understand, yeah, that'd be wonderful. But, you know, would it be right to knock down a listed building to get at something that other research has shown there's not really anything left there anyway? So you have to really make it, because we're being told where to go and what to do, have to really make that robust. Now, luckily, Blaken is nearly 1 mile from Chester. So, theoretically, we thought, if we're 1 mile from Chester, which is soaked in history and archaeology, maybe that might have spread out a little bit. And we do know, through historical records, that Blaken was involved in the Civil War. Blaken Manor came down during the Civil War. There was, as the parliamentarians were coming through from Wales to hit Chester, there was almost like a scorched earth policy put out, and manors were told to burn down. Now, Blaken Manor wasn't in the list of the manors that were told to burn down, but it is mentioned in the list of manors that burnt down later. So we've got that. We've got, you know, good Civil War activity going on in Blaken as well. So it started that, well, we've got something to work from here. And this is the extent of the research area in red. And we chose that very small area because we have Blaken Hall. Now, that's not Blaken Manor. Blaken Manor, we think, was placed elsewhere, nearer the River Dee, but that has really been industrially built up. You've got all the Seal and Road industrial works and shops around there now. So we've got Blaken Manor. This is a 17th century map. And we know Blaken Hall, was there in the 17th century. So we had a starting point. Blaken Hall wasn't there anymore, but we had a starting point that we could then work from, do the research, do the DBAs, and make it a decent community project. Hopefully, make it a decent community project. And happily, at the end of the day, we did find Blaken Hall, and this was, we were in at the school, again because it was done on health, we did focus partly on the school there, St. Teresa's Primary School, and in their school grounds, exactly where the map said it should be, we found evidence of Blaken Hall, which was an absolute delight, and as you can imagine, the school were thrilled to bits with that. And what went on from that, the school children digging with us, finding Blaken Hall, and that wasn't the limit of it. I will explain more about the health aspects more thoroughly. That they went on to want a mini museum curated within the school. So while we were going through the process of post-excavation and getting things ready for archiving, we curated a little mini museum in St. Teresa's School. And when I went to remove it, which would have been at the end of the summer term last year, because it was ready now to be put into Chester Museum, the archive, the children there who were helping me disassemble it remembered everything. They had really connected with what they'd done, and they remembered everything. They understood the terminologies. They remembered what they'd found, where they'd found it. So the connection with the children then sort of builds, and hopefully in an area of a big deprivation, and vandalism and all the other things that go on with that, we're really hoping that then they get some more connectivity to the area, which could then lessen those problems. So that's a little overview of Blaken, but as I said, the main focus had to be on health. So Dig Blaken, we think, is the first project in the whole of the UK that was specifically commissioned through public health needs and well-being attitudes. But what is health? Is it just the amount of calories you burn? Is it just the amount of steps you take? Has to be highlighted though, other projects have seen health benefits. Quite specifically, Project Nightingale with the ex-servicemen is a really famous one, which has seen huge impact on mental and physical health with the ex-servicemen. But that wasn't commissioned specifically for that. We think this one is the only one that's been specifically commissioned with health reasons. Obviously, to make it a robust archaeological excavation, we did all the standard things. We did geophysical survey. And what we did, we monitored volunteers. I had to be the first one that was monitored. So we've got this first person, volunteer one. On the geophys day, I had a Fitbit on, which monitored what I did. And in an afternoon, I walked 13,109 steps. I covered 5.65 miles. And I burned 2,523 calories just through doing geophys survey. Volunteer two, he walked slightly further than me. He walked 14,000 steps, 6 miles, but only used 2,103 calories. He was slightly smaller than me, so the whole mass thing, you know, he burnt less calories than I did. So huge amount of calories used just walking, but for a long time, and just walking up and down a field. And it's not hard work, but you're covering huge amounts of space. Now, the other one that I've got up here to show you, I'm just whizzing through this because the more important stuff really comes later. We were doing test pitting with the community, not big open area excavation. And a 22-year-old volunteer was tracked by the Fitbit, and a 1 meter by 1 meter standard test pit actually involves excavation and backfilling of between 1.2 and 1.7 metric tons of soil. Now, when I excavate a test pit, it comes out very nicely, but it does feel like a metric ton of soil when you're shoveling it back into the test pit at the end of the night. And our young, healthy 22-year-old volunteer used 2,773 calories excavating and backfilling a test pit. It's a huge amount of calories being used. But importantly, this is what we actually find through watching the volunteers. This last bit, the record showed huge increase in heart rate, significant calorie burn, but there was no excessive exertion. What happened, when we were watching, the volunteers would work, and then they'd sit back and have a little bit of a rest, and someone else would do a bit. So they were monitoring their own exertion levels. If they got tired, they'd sit down and rest and watch. And then get back up again. So they were using all this energy, increased heart rate, calories burned, but it wasn't excessive. It wasn't like going out and running, you know, half marathon or something. And there was no prerequisite of fitness required because it was done in short. If anyone's done any excavation, you don't go constantly. You do a bit, rest, do a bit, rest. And so the actual fitness in archaeology was absolutely brilliant. The results we got were absolutely brilliant. More importantly though, what I wanted to talk about is that all it is with health and well-being? Health and well-being involves more than just calories burned, the amount of steps taken, whether your heart's increased a little bit to make you breathless. What this picture shows here is what they call themselves the Here and Now group at Blaken, and it's elderly and terminally ill people. The lady in pink is no longer with us. She had terminal lung cancer and she died, but they came out. This group, we got in touch with the group, would they like to come out and see what we were doing? Not only did they want to see what they were doing, they wanted to get involved as well and join in. And so, thinking, is it just about steps burned? No. These are people, you know, terminally ill lung cancer is debilitating and very isolating. She got out and she had an afternoon out with us. Social isolation is a big one. In areas of such
I don't want to use the wrong words because it's very easy to use the wrong words here, but deprivation, really. Social isolation is a big thing. People don't get out of the houses. They stay there. They've not got the money to do things. And so they're lonely, and that can lead to huge problems, huge mental health problems. And so we're trying to access people through that way, through social isolation. The two main aspects I wanted to talk to you about, though, I can't give you any photographs because of the vulnerability of the people. The first group, there is a homeless shelter in Blaken, and we got in touch with the homeless shelter and asked them whether they had any way of getting people out and digging with us. And they did. We had members of the homeless shelter come out and dig with us. Bit by bit, they'd come in and they'd go, and that was entirely fine. But then a couple of weeks later, we got a phone call from the lady who runs it. Would one of us go and talk about the results we're getting? So we went, and we went to the homeless shelter, and a third of the residents turned out to sit in their living communal area to find out what we've been doing in Blaken. And just because of a phone call we made, trying to think outside the box, who wouldn't normally get involved in an archaeological excavation, a third of those residents wanted to find out about it. Now, whether that was just it was something to do and they were bored, or whether they had a genuine interest in what was going on, I've got no idea. I really don't. But it gave an opportunity for people to find out about what's going on in the area where they were. Unfortunately, because of the nature of homeless shelters, people go, they might get housed, they go to all different areas, so we don't know. We have no follow-up on what happened there. But still, it was something we accessed people who wouldn't normally access archaeology and heritage. One that we do have definitive levels of impact, Chester has a young person's mental health ward, two wards. It has an acute ward in the Countess of Chester, the hospital, and it has a long-term ward in a house outside. And we got in touch with them. Are any of your residents well enough to come out and dig with us? And some of them were, and it worked to varying degrees. Some of them stayed an hour. Some of them stayed 10 minutes, because some of these young people, teenagers with mental health problems, some of them were really quite poorly. So, but our attitude was, if it just gets them out, even for 10 minutes, half an hour, it's something different in their lives that could have a positive impact. But they then got back in touch. The residents really enjoyed what they did. Is there any way we can further this? And so we thought, well, we could, with care, take some post-excavation down to them. We could take some fines washing. Now again, these are very poorly people, so we had to be very careful what we took. Nothing with sharp edges. But you know, you put a bit of effort into it and you can take things down, and we spent an afternoon with them doing post-ex work, which they thoroughly enjoyed. And then just 6-7 weeks ago, we got another phone call. We're getting a brand new building. The whole mental health unit is being put together for the young people, which is going to be so much better. And they're making a time capsule. And then they thought, why don't we get in touch with the archaeologists and see what we can do with them? And so because Big Heritage is a community interest company, parts of our profits are put to one side so we can afford to do community work, which we want to do. You know, we can choose what we do and what we don't do. And so we thought, yeah, this would be a really cool thing to be involved in. So again, there were four sessions, and these children, well, young adults, planned a time capsule, researched what a time capsule was, and made their own time capsule, which in the fullness of time will be buried in their new unit, outside their new unit. Now, from literally some of those youngsters staying with us for 10 minutes because they physically weren't well enough to stay any longer, that has had a huge impact, and they are now curating their own time capsules, doing their own research. It's giving them something else to think about. It's a huge step, and again, these are volunteers that wouldn't normally have been contacted and had access to an archaeological investigation. So really, in conclusion, alternative funding may present additional challenges. Alternative funding is difficult to fit into when you're an academic archaeologist, you know there are rules you have to follow if you don't want to be hammered by your peers that you're doing it all wrong and no one will ever trust you again. It does present challenges, but the results can be hugely successful, and the Aldig Blaken project, not only from the community viewpoint but from the archaeological viewpoint also, was a huge success. And personally, I've been lucky enough to be the one that's been involved mostly with the young people with mental health issues. I found that such a personally rewarding thing to be able to get involved in, to introduce people who wouldn't normally ever have any access to archaeology or heritage. These people at that point, they're locked in. They can only go out with company, and particularly the mental health children and the homeless. Letting people, those homeless guys would never walk into a museum. That would be way too intimidating for them to do in their current state. But letting them access heritage and archaeology has been hugely rewarding.